gospel lesson comes from John 2, 1 through 11. On the third day, a wedding took place in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Dear woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My time has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood six stone jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washings, each holding about 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that it had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have served the best and saved the best till now." This was the first of his miraculous signs Jesus performed at Cana of Galilee. He thus received his glory, and his disciples put their faith in him. So ends the reading of the word.
Marriages are fun. Marriages are expensive. I read this week that a wedding, average wedding in the United States today costs $27,000. You could get a new car. In fact, a friend of mine back in the 70s got married. His fiancée's father said, "I will either give you a new car or the wedding of your dreams." And she went with her dreams. About 2 years later, after they broke up, they kind of wished they'd had the car. They could have sold the car. Now, our own wedding, Sherry and I, cost us a grand total of $300. That covered the cost of the honorarium to the preacher and the pianist and the buying the cake and the cloth for Sherry's wedding dress and announcements and invitations. Now, that was the best investment I ever made in my life, even when I looked that young. Because we got back $300 in cash plus the gifts and all of the delight of the wedding, plus 41 years we've had together. It kind of worked. I don't know if money really makes it work, but weddings are fun. And if you really want to have fun, bring a kid into the wedding party, because invariably you'll have something go wrong and it'll be memorable. Or get your bridal party maybe just a little ripped, and then you'll do something like this.
One, two, three, four.
Now, we have to remember that Jesus was not a Methodist. And nobody ever runs out of wine at a Methodist wedding, right? Because there is none. A good Methodist would never drink, smoke, cuss, spit, dance, or play cards. Do I hear that again? My great-grandmother, Jessie Hahn, was a good Methodist. Her husband, my great-grandfather, Henry Hahn, was a good German, and he liked to make his elderberry wine. And every year, he made 2 crocks of elderberry wine, and my great-grandmother then would sneak in, and she would pour vinegar in one of those crocks. Never was the same crock. I mean, it was all confused, because she deeply believed that no man needed more than 1 crock of wine in a year. Evidently, somebody did not bring enough crocks of wine to the wedding in Cana, and it ran out. And that's hard. The wedding is over. Now, I read this week somebody who wrote that the weddings in Cana in Galilee in the first century were a 7-day affair, and that this was the 3rd day of the wedding, about halfway through, and they ran out of wine. But I don't know, because these are peasants. They don't have a lot of money. And they have to work very, very, very hard for what little money they have. They don't have time to spend 7 days partying. But one time when I heard somebody read this passage, and they started off on the 3rd day, and my mind was going, he rose from the dead. While they were saying there was a wedding in Cana. And I suddenly realized that's a clue. John is giving us a clue. That number 3 again. On the 3rd day, we've got, you know, remember the 3 wise men, the 3 gifts, the 3 faces of God, and the 3rd day. John is talking about something more. He's talking about a wedding. He's talking about a mother. He's talking about the wine. But and he's also talking about a real wedding, I think. But John never tells a story if he can't wrap it around things that we can't talk about. We don't have the words to talk about what it means for God to come into our lives. And this wedding helps us. This story helps us to understand what's going on. When we hear that term on the 3rd day, we should see a sign flashing, allegory, 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 because John is going to take us somewhere that is more about the truth than it is about facts. Have to remember that. John had the revelation that we have in the book of Revelation. And as we heard today, he saw a new Jerusalem descending as a bride, dressed beautifully for the groom. The bride, New Jerusalem, that's the church, that's us. And we are dressed beautifully, prepared to meet the groom who is Christ. Weddings are like that, because this is the initiation in the revelation that God will dwell among us and will always be with us. You know, back in the late 90s, we had a whole string of 50th anniversaries. One after the other, after the other, after the other. And I was wondering, first of all, why do we have so many at once? And secondly, why were they sort of spaced out like that? And I found out the reason. After the Second World War was over, these GIs had to save up points. They had to make points doing various things to get shipped back home. That's how they organized it. So it was the U.S. Army who organized all those 50th wedding anniversaries by letting the guys get home at various times. But it must be like that for the guys, that they are coming home to a wedding and to a life, and they will dwell with their wife and their family forever. That's the kingdom. That's the kind of joy we're talking about. There are a lot of problems in the world today. The wine runs out. If you watch the news, you know there's Benghazi and Sandy Hook and something in Algeria and something else in Maui and Mali. And
they're rioting in Africa. They're starving in Spain. There's hurricanes in Florida, and Disneyland needs rain. The whole world is The French hate the Germans. The Germans hate the Poles. Italians hate Yugoslavs. South Africans hate the Dutch.
And I don't like anybody very much.
That's called the Merry Minuet. It was sung by the Kingston Trios in the 50s, early 60s, and it was written in 1949. So, I mean, things are pretty much the same. The only thing that's changed are the names. That's just to keep journalists something to write about, to keep the advertisements from banging together. It's part of who we are. And things go wrong. And then Mother Mary, I have pondered for years what Mary's relationship here was all about, because she says what we always say when things don't go right. She says, Jesus, fix it. Fix it. Things are going wrong. We got to fix it. We got to find an answer. We got to get it right. You know, ever since the massacre at Sandy Hook at Newtown, we've been talking about firearms. On one hand, there's not one of us who wants to see that kind of tragedy, that horrendous death and suffering that's involved in little children being shot. On the other hand, firearms are central to our character as a nation. We have the Minutemen and Wyatt Earp and Bat Masterson and even Bernard Goetz. I mean, holding a gun is important to us. I mean, deeply, deeply important. So how do we fix it? Is there too much violence on television? I mean, the backbone of television drama is shooting people. The backbone of video games is shooting people. But I got to ask you, was there nobody shot before there was television? You know? We have to somehow fix it, and I think it goes a lot deeper than just rules and regulations. It goes down to understanding who we are. Sometimes there is no fix in this world. And that's why Jesus said, Mother, please, it's not my time. His time was to usher in the end of the evil age. His time was to bring the world out of this universe of time and space. That's why the wine runs out, you know. We live in a world where things run down. We try to fix things, and inevitably our fixes break too. And Jesus is saying, this is not the time for it. We have to wait. And maybe that's what we have to do. Maybe we have to understand that these things go wrong, but what do we do with that? I'm not sure. I think it is love others, help others, and learn to grow up in the midst of the things going wrong. And do our best to make things better. Mary, being a mother, being a Jewish mother, she just goes around Jesus' silly objections and says to the servants, listen to him and do whatever he tells you. Boy, she walked him right in there, right, moms? You set it up just right, and they have to do it. And he did. He didn't bring the old wine. In Revelation, John talks about the old heaven and the old earth passing away, and there's no more sea. And then God brings the new earth and the new heaven and the new Jerusalem. It's a whole new world. So Jesus does not bring old wine. He doesn't go out to the corner liquor store and buy a bunch of wine. The old wine. He brings a new wine. A new way of the Spirit in people's lives. You know, elsewhere Jesus said that you don't put new wine in old wineskins, right? And even as Methodists, we know why. Wine ferments. New wine will ferment. It'll create carbon dioxide and it will burst. The new wine doesn't fit, and the new spirit does not fit in the old institutions. That's probably why a lot of people say, I don't believe in organized religion. They don't believe in the institution. Well, rightfully so, because the institution becomes idolatry. It is the wine that we are to worship and search for and be with. And besides, if they didn't like the organized religion, they should come here, because there's nobody more disorganized than we are. No, it's more than that. There's a thing going around now in the spiritual community, which is kind of church plus all the New Agers and the church and the others, who are saying a new consciousness is coming into the world. I think it's the new wine. And it doesn't fit in the institutions. We're struggling with that. I was reading on Facebook this week, Bishop Elaine, our bishop, was meeting with others, people at the top of our terribly disorganized denomination. They're saying, what good is it to take all those statistics? We measure confirmation class and baptism and new members and attendance and outside studies and all of those things. And we have all these statistics, but we can't figure out how to get to the new wine, because I think the statistics don't tell us. They tell us the result, maybe, of the new wine, but they don't tell us where to go to find it. And we obsess on that. Maybe we shouldn't. On the other hand, I had a professor who said that if you want to create change, you change what you measure. So we need to start measuring things like, how do we teach preteens to do theology? How do we as adults study the Bible and grow in our faith, in our way of thinking and talking and being with God? Or is it just all about being a big church? That's Adam Hamilton, who has the biggest church in the United Methodist Church. He's a brilliant guy, and I love his stuff. But being the big church is not everything. I don't know what to do. But I think if there's an answer, Mary had it. When the wine runs out, we servants of the Lord need to listen to Jesus and do what he says. Thank you.